Welcome to the City of Orlando. For those of you who don't know, none of the Walt Disney World Resort is actually located in the City of Orlando. As a matter of fact, there are several miles between the Disney theme parks and the closest part of Orlando city limits. Universal, however, is in the City of Orlando. Usually, you have many options for entertainment in the city. Plays at Bob Carr, large productions at the Dr. Phillips Center or the Amway Center. We have several professional sports teams like the Magic, the Orlando City Lions, the Solar Bears hockey team, and the Orlando Anarchy, a women's professional football team. The NFL Pro Bowl is usually played right here, in addition to college football's the Cure Bowl and the Camping World Bowl. I say usually because, well, COVID-19 virus has closed all the venues, but not the parks. Today we're going to head into the downtown area of the City of Orlando. To this day, Orlando calls itself by the title that was suggested by Mrs. W.S. Branch Sr., who won the naming contest in 1908, and they call it the City Beautiful. Originally begun in 1898 to address the problems of tenements in places like London and New York, the City Beautiful movement was a modern civic arts movement that saw city planners, architects, and artists all come together to plan a city. Orlando had taken a planned approach for as long as anyone could remember, planting trees to overhang the roadways back in the late 1800s. Making the streets out of bricks, something my back has screamed about since they started uncovering them again. And one of the points of the City Beautiful movement put forward was the need for city parks. Prior to the movement, Orlando had established a large park downtown around Lake Eola in 1883, when the owner of the Summerlin Hotel, Jacob Summerlin, donated the land to the city. Summerlin wanted a beautiful park with trees and a driveway around the park, so much so that he put a revision clause that would return the property to his heirs. His sons had named the lake Eola after a lady they knew, Eola J. Allen. The area was officially declared a park in 1892. The park has also been home to a zoo, a horse racetrack, tennis courts, a pier with a dance area, and the broadcast site of a local radio station. The beautiful lake in the park is actually a 23-foot deep sinkhole, give or take 8 inches. In 1912, the first fountain was installed at a cost of $10,000, which equivalent today is $373,292.63. A replacement for the fountain, originally dubbed the Centennial Fountain, was installed in 1957 at a cost of $350,000. Again, that's $3,221,967.97 now. The actual name of the fountain is the Lyndon E. Allen Memorial Fountain. The iconic water feature is also the official symbol of the City of Orlando. The driveway, required by Summerlin's agreement, has become a 9/10 of a mile sidewalk circling the park. That makes it the perfect place to get that exercise authorized by the stay-at-home executive orders of both the mayor of the city and the mayor of the county, and the governor and the president. Also located in the park is a restaurant, the Relaxed Grill. It's pretty good. It's located not far from the Bandshell on Roslyn Avenue side of the park, but I'm pretty sure that right now that's curbside pickup only. When we visit, I try to park over by the end of Osceola Avenue next to the World of Beer. There's a handicap spot there that's usually empty. By the way, the World of Beer is located in the old Cherry Plaza, the hotel where Walt Disney announced the Walt Disney World project. There are several things to see besides the fountain, like another fountain. There are sculptures all over the park, complete with plaques to tell you the name and, of course, who paid for it. Preserving its history, Orlando didn't bow to public pressure and remove their Confederate veteran statue. History is history. Although what they did to historic Tinker Field is an out-and-out crime. But that's for another video. See, there really is a lot to see beside the fountain. But remember, we're exercising, so we can't stop and look at them. But through the magic of video, we can. And we don't have to feel the surface of the sun level heat this way. Although there is an awful lot of shade in Lake Eola Park. There's also a set of restrooms at both ends of the park. But, I don't recommend them. I mean, cops can't be everywhere. Probably one of the more recognizable places in the park is the Red Pagoda, built in Shanghai and gifted by Dr. Nelson Ying in honor of Orlando's sister city, Guilin, China. It's technically a Ting because it's only one story. So I guess it's a Ying Ting? One of my favorite places at Lake Eola is the Fantasy Swan Water Sculpture. I don't know why, it's just kind of peaceful, I guess. Of all the statues in the park, I really like the one called Take Flight. I've always been fascinated by birds, and you know, you can join other Floridians with the Fish and Wildlife Conservation Commission's free bird spotting guide. You can even apply for a Wings Over Florida spotting certificate. I'll put a link down in the comments. The other fountain in the park is the Sperry Fountain. And the Sperry Fountain was actually the first fountain to be installed in Lake Eola back in 1914. However, the original iron fountain was eventually replaced by a bronze replica in 2011 because, well, it was falling apart. On the opposite side of the lake, right near Relax, you can rent swan boats to paddle around the lake. They won't let you go out in bad weather like thunderstorms, so morning might be best. Also, it's $15 for 30 minutes. Just a little further down the path is the sculpture, the Muse of Discovery. It's kind of a climb-all-over statue. It reminds me a lot of the Awakening that used to be in the East Potomac Park in D.C. and is now located in Prince George's County, Maryland. Every year, the City of Orlando lights up their official Christmas tree at the park. It's located right next to the park's venue site, the Walt Disney Amphitheater at Lake Eola. The park's had some kind of a bandstand since 1889. Originally, it was on the other side of the lake, but was torn down and a new one constructed at its present site. It's been the Disney band shell since 1989 when Disney renovated it and became its sponsor. It's also been repainted in remembrance of the victims of the Pulse nightclub. That brings us back to the Linton E. Allen Memorial Fountain. The current fountain was built in 1959 and it isn't located where they wanted it. Originally it was supposed to be in the center of the lake and centered on Washington Street. Now, as I stated before, the lake is really a sinkhole. So when the construction company got ready to put in the first piling, it was carefully arranged and set, and then quickly disappeared into the 200-foot deep sinkhole. The fountain was then moved about 40 yards closer to Washington Street. Bob Upsell from Channel 9 did an excellent documentary, which is available several places online. It's worth a watch if you want to see how the fountain works. I went back to talking about the fountain as a way of avoiding talking about the southwest corner of the park. It's home to the kinetic sculpture centered by Oregon's C.J. Wrench. He specializes in large-scale metal sculptures, and centered is just one of dozens he's created across the United States. That being said, give it a quick glance, click a quick pick, and move on. The bushes nearby are where the less savory population of Orlando hang out, and a confrontation is extremely possible, but maybe OPD will address this after the issues with the pandemic. Lastly, there's one more sculpture I'd like to talk about. Most of you know I love history, and since moving to Orlando 20 years ago, I've fallen in love with Orlando's history. You may also have seen one of my videos on German POWs in Orlando. I'll link it right there above. Well, besides the multiple bases in the area and the sons that Orlando gave to the war effort, Orlando has another connection to World War II. It's a relatively new sculpture dedicated in 1999 and created by local sculptor Chris Scala. It was unveiled on the 55th anniversary of the Battle of the Bulge and depicts a World War II GI. Scala also duplicated a sister monument for a memorial in Clairvaux, Luxembourg. So maybe after the stay-at-home orders are lifted, we can head back over to Lake Eola, grab a bite to eat at the Relax Grill, and take a stroll around this beautiful park. Let's hope it happens before the next Christmas tree lighting.
Always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the light side of life. If life seems jolly rotten, there's something you've forgotten, and that's to laugh and smile and dance and sing. When you're feeling in the dumps, don't be silly chumps, just purse your lips and whistle, that's the thing.
Always look on the bright side of life.
Come on.
Always look on the bright side of life.
For life is quite absurd.
could really use your help as an As Bob Sees It team member on Patreon. When Disney reopens, I'm pretty sure they'll raise prices, and for as little as $1 a month, you can help make sure that I can continue to make these videos. There's a link in the description down below, and I'd really appreciate any help that you can give. If you like this video, why not give it a big thumbs up? That way YouTube will let others know about it too. And soon the whole world will know about As Bob Sees It. Oh, sorry. But seriously, I try to make sure I post a new video every Friday, so if you like these videos, why not subscribe? It's free, just hit the subscribe button down below. But you know, in its old age, YouTube sometimes forgets things, like the fact that you're subscribed to As Bob Sees It. So, to make sure you're notified, make sure you click on that bell icon. That way you'll be notified the next time I upload a video. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.